El bono se va a necesitar. El esquema de esta reunión, el esquema de esta reunión es que Michael Novak va a hacer uso de la palabra durante 30 minutos, tocando algunos de los temas que desarrolla en su libro, y luego tendremos tiempo para preguntas del público. Les ruego que las preguntas sean preguntas y sean breves. Yo no voy a hacer mayores presentaciones de Michael Novak, que ustedes conocen muy bien, es un viejo amigo de la casa. Ha estado aquí un año y tres veces. Hemos traducido muchas de sus obras que están en la revista Estudios Públicos. Quisiera mencionar solamente la última que apareció ahí, 8 argumentos sobre la moralidad del mercado, que apareció en el número 55 de invierno del año pasado, donde también publicamos un artículo de Monseñor John Jones y el reverendo Robinson. Hay toda una discusión ahí sobre el tema ética y mercado que es bien interesante. La última obra de Novak es La ética católica y el espíritu del capitalismo, que está a disposición a partir de ayer. Esta es una obra en que de alguna manera se hace un comentario de la doctrina social de la Iglesia en relación con la economía, y creo que ese será el eje de la conversación de hoy. Dejo con ustedes entonces a Michael Novak.
I want to thank you, first of all, for your patience in waiting for me to arrive. I'm very grateful. Second, to express my thanks to Centro Estudios Públicos for over the years translating so many of my writings.
I'm sorry. I repeat, I first want to thank you for your patience in waiting for my late arrival, for which I apologize. Second, to thank Centro Estudios Públicos for, over so many years, translating my writings, but more important, inviting me to Chile so I could learn new things from interesting people who were experimenting in the new direction. It was a very important experience for me, especially in the beginning. Finally, I will say that today I will try to make 3 points. I'm a committed Trinitarian to the bitter end. I find it better usually to make 3 points. If there are 3 gods in one, 3 persons in one, he made the world in such a way that when you speak in threes, people can understand better. 4 is not so good. 2 is not enough. 3 is exactly right. The first point I want to make is a point that John Paul II made before the United Nations 5 weeks ago. Liberty, he said, is the main story, the main narrative of the 20th century. And if you read Incentesimus with Honors, his great encyclical of 1991, he writes in paragraph 42 that there are 3 systems of liberty, not 1. Liberty is a complicated concept. It involves political liberty, the rule of law, limited government, the rights of minorities and individuals, a constitutional order, in short. Even if you don't have a constitution, as in Britain, you need a constitutional order. And second, a free economy, an economy where people's right to personal initiative is respected, where personal creativity is respected. Well, even for people who are poor, there are institutions to help them use their creativity, education, venture capital, cheap credit, etc. And finally, is required moral liberty, or religious liberty, because we are not just political animals or economic animals. We are animals who hunger for the truth and for love. So all 3 systems are required. The true free society is a Trinitarian society. Surprise. three crucial liberties are necessary. The second point I want to make is about the nature of capitalism. According to John Paul II, but also according to the truth. And this is not a point that John Paul II invented, it's something that he observed. Capitalism is a new kind of system, and it depends on something immaterial. It is the first system to recognize that the most important economic value is the human mind, not land, not even work, but the inventiveness, the creativity of the human mind. Now, he saw this as a philosopher. His major book was called The Acting Person. What makes a person different from a cat is that cats only behave. But human persons can imagine new futures and create new futures. That's to act. Human beings, every woman and every man, is made in the image of the Creator. That means to create. And the more capitalism progresses, the more immaterial things become. If you buy a computer program, word printed, let us say, I'm not promoting IBM or dismissing Apple, I'm just, you name the program. In the beginning, 5-6 years ago, it cost $300 to buy WordPerfect, $295. But what did you buy? You got a big box in it, a little piece of plastic, worth no more than 85 cents. So the material value was worth 85 cents. But what was important was the logic and the information encoded on it. What was important was the immaterial matter that was there. And so all around the world, industries are becoming smaller, cleaner, and the products have in them more intelligence and less matter. Even if you go to have your car fixed, in the old days, in the mechanical, in the industrial age, you took your car to be fixed, the man went under the hood, and he got all greasy and dirty, and he came up and tried to clean his hands, and he billed you $134. Most of it was for labor. Nowadays, they open up the car hood, they hook you up to a diagnostic machine, which they diagnose electronically what's wrong. Then he reaches in and he releases a clip, and he takes out a little electronic component about this big, and he puts another one in, fix it in, and he bills you $154. But his hands are not even dirty. The automobile components are more and more electronic and less mechanical. It's quite astonishing. Well, so the second point I want to make is the nature of capitalism is in the direction of the immaterial and the product of mind. To see that much more valuable than land is the human mind. The whole meaning of wealth has been transformed. Capitalism is the system based upon kaput, the old head. That's why I prefer the name. The Pope does not like that name. Marx has spent 130 years trying to denigrate the name, capitalism. They made capitalism synonymous with everything evil. So in much of the world, we cannot use that word. The Pope prefers to talk about the free economy, the business economy, the creative economy, but he says he can also say capitalism. This is in paragraph 42 of Contagion of Honest. For the reason I said I prefer the word capitalism, because it refers to kaput. What really is important in capitalism is not the market, not private property. Those are significant, but they're not the... That you had in the Bible, that there's a role. What's new is an economy oriented to the mind, to invention, to discovery, to enterprise, and to the institutions that bring social support to the mind. So that's the second point, the nature of the mind. The third point I want to make is concerned with the term social justice. It's a very important term. but it's almost always misused. If you look at all the sentences that say social justice in them, in the last year in Chile, and you, I tell you what, go to your computer, the Nexus, and plug in social justice, and bring up all the references to social justice. I will predict that 90% of them is pure socialism. It's just an ideological use of the term to mean the state should do something. But think for a moment. When was the term first used in Catholic circles? The first use is in 1891. I can give you an earlier use, but it's in an obscure theologian in Sicily. It's not important. The first time it became authoritatively used was 1891 in Rerum Novarum. If social justice is so important, why did it wait for 1860 years after Christ before it was used? There's a reason, but nobody knows it. I feel sure if I ask you why, nobody will raise their hands and say, I'll tell you why. But there's a reason, it's an important question. Moreover, it was used by Leo XIII in 1891, uncertainly. Sometimes he wrote social justice or social charity. And then he could not make up his mind. And sometimes he said social justice, and sometimes he said social charity. It is clear that he felt there's a need for something new. There's a new term needed. But he wasn't sure how to call it, and he did not offer a definition. But as often happens, intuition comes first. The exact concept comes later. Now, Pope Leo XIII is famous for three things. First, he was the Pope of associations. Second, he's the Pope who condemned socialism, who said no one can be both a Catholic and a socialist at the same time. He said socialism is an evil system. But more interestingly, he said, socialism is futile. No matter how they huff and puff, no matter what they do, they will never make it work. And he gave 10 reasons why this is so. And after 1989, when socialism failed, and everybody saw that it was futile, the people who lived under it gave their reasons why it didn't work. And there were 10 reasons. They were all the ones the other 13 picked out. It was incredibly prescient. Remember, 1891, there was no example of a socialist state. No one ever saw one. Practically all the intellectuals were in favor of socialism. Even John Stuart Mill changed his mind. He was against it at first, but his wife was a socialist. And the wives are, they claim they are oppressed. Well, I don't know what it is like in Chile, but in England, John Stuart Mill's wife persuaded him that socialism might work. And Pope Leo XIII was very eager not to give, he condemned socialism, he certainly didn't want to support it. So he was looking for an alternative. That's the point. He stressed, the third point he was famous for, is in all his writings, he kept stressing change, the great changes of the 19th century. He could see people moving from the country to the city. Change and how to deal with it was the main theme of his writings. His main positive proposal is that we need to promote more associations. We need Catholic action. We need Catholics to form unions, to form associations of entrepreneurs, to form associations of craftsmen, like the guilds, etc. We need the Red Cross, Boy Scouts, all every kind of... Why did he say that? Because if you don't want the state to run everything, like socialism, there has to be an alternative. And the alternative is free people forming their own associations. Well, Tocqueville had written, the first law of democracy is the principle of association. If you don't want the state to dominate the social landscape, you need an alternative. And the alternative is free people forming their own associations and doing what they need themselves, not turning to the state. By the way, this idea comes from the New World. Germán Mazariegos, the Colombian historian, says that Columbus did not discover America. America discovered Europe. He says that all the ideas which now govern Europe originated in America, the principle of association. Tocqueville writes that at the time of the French Revolution, there were not 10 people in all of France who were capable of living in association, of forming association. It may be an exaggeration, but you take his point. Whereas in America, he said, everybody lives in associations. In America, they don't do anything without forming an association. There are associations for building universities. There are associations for raising money to support the missions. There are associations to put up a school. There are associations to build a bridge. In America, there was a very weak state. And in order to do things, the pioneers had to join together and do them. You couldn't call up the federal office and have them do it, wasn't it? If you wanted it done, you had to do it. If you wanted a church, you had to build it, and so forth. Well, let me answer this third question first then. Why social justice, and what is social justice? The term originated already in the time of Aristotle, but excuse me, not the term, but the idea. Not the words. The words social justice are foreign to Aristotle, to St. Thomas Aquinas. But the idea was not foreign. They saw that justice is a crucial virtue, a crucial habit for a good man to have. A good man says the right words at the right time. He treats his servants in the right way. He treats his sons and daughters in the right way. He treats his equals in the right way. He gives to each one his due, exactly what is due him, with wisdom. That's justice. But then they also thought, what about those young men who died at Thermopylae, at the pass, protecting Athens? Didn't they give their lives for the city? Isn't that a special virtue? Isn't that a form of justice? They felt they owed it to the city. They gave the city what they owed it, but they gave it willingly. They didn't want to die. They were afraid. No doubt they were afraid. They knew they would die. But they gave their lives willingly because they loved the city, and they thought anybody would do it to protect the city. Isn't that a special virtue? And they came close to calling it general justice, but it's not a good term. In any case, they raised the question, so the question lingered. But it disappeared. And nobody talked about social justice until 1891. Why did Pope Leo XIII need it? Because he saw many things going wrong in Europe. People were moving from the countryside, where to live by subsistence, at the level of subsistence, is possible. You can grow enough food. You don't need much income. All over Europe, the peasant class, the farming class, was relatively poor, but they lived. Si viva. I had a friend in Italy. I asked him why he went to America. He spoke English a little bit. He was a gardener. He said he went to Cleveland, he called it. Cleveland. Fare fortuna, he said, to make money. I said, then why did you come back to Italy? He said, a vivere. A shave and a haircut takes 2 hours. It's wonderful. Dinner is 5 hours. It's great. He said, in America, everybody eats quick and goes to meetings. He said, you work 8 hours a day, then you go to 8 hours of meeting. What are you doing here? It's the same thing here in Chile, I said. In America, there's too many meetings. So he came back to Italy, a vivere. Well, going to meetings is an important part of a free society. It's the principle of association. Besides your family, you belong to many organizations. And so, every night at dinner, somebody is at a meeting. So, Leo XIII was arguing that in many places in Europe, only the man works, the wife doesn't work. But the man is not paid enough in his new job in the city to buy food, to pay rent, to pay for education, etc. It's not a living wage. He said, that's wrong. The family needs a living wage. So he said, we must do something about it. He did not say, the state must do something about it. That would be socialism. And he was not defending socialism. He was looking for an alternative. But we must do something about it. So he was trying to call for a new virtue in people. Something new responsibility that Catholics would have to undertake. To look around at society, see what is wrong or imperfect, and then in some way change it. Well, the term was not more clearly defined until 40 years later in Quadri Gesimoana. And 10 times, Pius XI uses the phrase social justice. He does not define it. If you look in all the Catholic theology books that there are many chapters on social justice, but there's not a definition. But if you look at the 10 times that the Pius XI used the term, just take out the sentences and line them up on a page, you can see that they all have certain characteristics. First, always he identifies something wrong that makes it difficult, especially for families. And then there is an appeal that we must form associations, we must do something to deal with it. And now you see why the virtue is called social justice. First of all, it is a virtue. It is a habit which people either have or don't have. Consider the habit of speaking Spanish. It is, alas, a habit which all of you possess, but I do not. And it's a very valuable habit. If I spoke Spanish, I could speak more quickly. I wouldn't need a translator. I could understand everything that people say to me. It would be a big help. But I don't have it. So there's some things I cannot do. I cannot write the best poetry. Spanish is the language of poets. French is the language of chefs. Italian is the language of lovers. English is the language of common sense. So when you don't have one of these habits, it's a little more difficult in a certain area to do. There's no good Spanish word for enterprise, meaning the virtue of enterprise. You will be more clear if you say personal initiative, the virtue of personal initiative or something. You can come close, but not exactly. There's no good Spanish term for what we mean in English, American English, by compromise. Democracy is not possible without compromise. In Spanish, it sounds like compromiso, it sounds like compromising principles. Totally different meaning. It's the same in Polish. That's why there are 38 political parties in Poland. Nobody can work together. The Pope has a special joke about this. He says there's only two cures for the Polish problem, which namely is those who believe in democracy can't get together, the communists win. So all the people who believe in liberty have separate parties. And they don't cooperate. He said there are only two solutions to the Polish crisis, the realistic solution and the miraculous solution. The realistic solution is if Our Lady of Częstochowa should suddenly appear with all the angels and saints and Moses and David and Jesus, and everybody, all the patriarchs, they all come and they solve the Polish crisis. That's the realistic solution. The miraculous solution will be if the Polish people cooperate. Social justice is the virtue of cooperation. It means that free people come together to face a problem and figure out a practical solution. And agree, everybody has to agree to get it done. Not to do what I want, not to do what you want, but to get the job done. You need a spirit of compromise. Your focus is the job. Accomplish the goal. Your focus is not get what I want, get the full principle. No. It's a special virtue. Not everybody has it. At the moment, the Polish citizens do not have it in this dimension. In Solidarność, I'm wearing a Solidarność button, They had it to overthrow communism. That was relatively clear. But to agree about how to form a free society, that is more difficult. And there they don't have it. The virtue of social justice is, first of all, a virtue. It's a personal habit. It's something that citizens have to have, or they can't make democracy work. Secondly, it's a special virtue. It's social in two senses. It means concentrating not on a personal problem, but a problem of the city. Something is wrong in the city. Something is wrong in the city of man. Something is wrong in the nation. Something is wrong in the hemisphere. So the object of the virtue of social justice is a social problem. And secondly, it's social in this sense. It is precisely the habit of being able to organize others to tackle a problem that one person alone cannot tackle. You see what I mean? It's a virtue of forming associations big enough to handle the problem, whatever the problem is. And secondly, it's the virtue of at least seeing the problem. Some people don't even see the problem. First to see a social problem, a problem of the city. Second, to form an association. That's what self-government means. If you turn to the state to solve the problem, you're not self-governing. You're a subject. You're dependent. The project of self-government is to do as much as possible ourselves without turning to the state. If you involve the state, you involve budgetary expense. You invite corruption. You create interests and create counterproductive tendencies. If you do it yourself, you avoid all those problems. It doesn't cost the public anything. No tax money. It doesn't invite favoritism to the government. And you learn by trial and error. If the project succeeds, you're happy. If it doesn't succeed, you're sad, but it doesn't succeed. In the government, if something doesn't succeed, they ask for more money. And they put more workers on it. There's a vested interest in failure. Every social problem in the United States, all the people who work on it through government, keep saying how bad things are getting. We need more money for it. The condition of the children is terrible. What's the solution? Give us more money. Give us more workers. And they make the situation more terrible. And 2 years later, they come back and say, it's getting worse. We need more. Ronald Reagan told a very funny story about this. It's not politically correct, I warn you. But he went to visit every branch of government. And one day he went to a certain welfare office. And it was the Bureau of Indian Affairs. And he saw one, it was a big room, practically empty. Like the newsroom in the movie, All the President's Men. You see all the desks the same, but there's only one man there. And he was crying, he was inconsolable. And the president turned to his supervisor and said, what's bothering the poor man? And the manager said, his Indian just died. And he had no more to do. It's not a nice story, but it illustrates the interest that a bureaucrat has in his clients. And if you read paragraph 48 of Chintesi Mathonas, that problem is described. The problem with the social assistance state, the Pope says, is that it costs too much money. Second, it takes human beings who need help and makes them clients. Third, it treats them in bureaucratic ways rather than in Christian ways. And so we need a correction of the social assistance state in a more humane way. Well, I've attempted to say for you the definition that I give of social justice in the book. It is a special virtue which adheres in persons, not in states, which free citizens have to practice. And it involves organizing other people to solve social problems so that we don't have to turn to the state. It's the main virtue of civil society. It's the main virtue in the experiment of self-government. We will not have self-government without many, many people practicing social justice. It's the opposite of socialism. This definition has several advantages. First, it explains what is the alternative to socialism that Leo XIII was looking for. Secondly, it explains why you call it a virtue in the Catholic tradition, in the tradition of Aristotle and Aquinas. It is a virtue of human beings. It's not a description of society. There's an inequality of incomes, some people say. That's a question of social justice. That's not quite right. That's simply a description of society. Who's fault in it? Who should change their behavior? What virtue is missing? That way of looking at things treats social justice not as a virtue, but as a description of society. Hayek had a very good objection. Most people, when they talk about social justice, do not mean a virtue. They mean a description of a society. What is, if it's a description of society, it's not a virtue. Therefore, it's not part of that moral tradition. And if it is a virtue, then it's not a description of society. It's a description of a person. I think it's a very powerful objection. And the third advantage of this definition of social justice, it explains why the concept arose in 1891. When my great-grandparents lived in Slovakia, in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, before they migrated to America, their children migrated to America, they had three main virtues they had to practice to be good people, good subjects of the emperor, and good Christians. I'm exaggerating a little, but not too much. Pray, pay, obey. If they did those three things, they were good subjects. Pray, pay, obey. And they were good Christians. When their children came to America, they had new responsibilities. They were no longer subjects of the emperor, they were citizens, which means they're sovereigns. The president of the United States is not a sovereign. He's an employee of the people. And if he doesn't do his job well, the people fire him. Even if he's a good man, like George Bush, they fired after one term. The sovereigns are the people. And if there is a problem, the people have to organize themselves and find leaders and solve the problem. In the economic order, my great-grandfather was the gamekeeper for the Duke, who lived in the castle, the ruins of the castle. He didn't even own his own property. People in his village were not allowed to own their own property until 1928. They were serfs, and they did not have full human rights. They had the diminished rights of serfs. But on the other hand, the job was secure. He got the job of gamekeeper because his father had it, and at least one of his sons would have it. But when the family came to America, there was no guarantees for a job. You didn't inherit a job. You had to go find one. You had to invent one. You had to start a business of your own. So there were economic responsibilities that they needed in America that they didn't need in Europe. And finally, more religious responsibilities. In Slovakia, you were born either Catholic or Lutheran. A few Calvinists, not much else. In America, you had to decide whether your religion belonged to the old country, or whether you should continue it. It became a personal choice. You either had to become a Catholic by conviction, or drift away, or just break. You could become something else if you wanted. But suddenly you had religious responsibilities and moral responsibilities of a new quality, which you did not have before. You could not merely inherit. Well, so three people have three sets of responsibilities that are new. Political, economic, and moral, religious. And this requires new virtues of a kind our ancestors did not have to have. And appropriate to a free people is the virtue of social justice, for the reasons that I mentioned earlier. But that explains, until liberty was available, political, economic, moral, people didn't need social justice. Their leaders took care of it. Their leaders made the decisions, and they just obeyed. But once people are free, they have to take responsibility for social decisions. And they need to form institutions to do that. Well, I think actually I said I was going to talk about three things, and in fact I have. I said that liberty has three differentiated types of liberty. Liberty from torture and tyranny, which is political liberty. Liberty from poverty, which is economic liberty, the aim of economic liberty. And liberty from censorship and oppression of conscience, so on, which is moral and cultural liberty, religious liberty. That's why typically liberal flags have three colors. Liberty is a complicated concept. Socialism essentially has one color, red. The first socialist flag was just a piece of red to suggest danger, fire, destruction, and the new dawn. The new utopia beginning. You know who designed the first socialist flag? Victor Hugo. They were in Paris, in I think 1831. The idea of liberty is complicated. The second point I wanted to make is that capitalism does not consist only in markets, private property, and profit. Those you had even in Jerusalem in the Bible. Capitalism is something new in the 17th and 18th centuries. At the heart of it as a system is it's a system of laws and institutions which support creativity, invention, discovery, enterprise. So the people with new ideas can find social support, even if they are born poor. And an incredible number of inventions in the Americas come from poor people. The children of rich people are sometimes very bright and sometimes very able. But often they do not have to sacrifice. And they do not learn a sense of realism. It's very hard for a rich family to maintain a sense of realism in its children. I often say of myself, I know how to bring up children for poverty because I was born very poor. My father used to give me a dime to go to a football game and say, bring it home. It's just for emergencies. I would know how to bring up children. I don't know how to bring up my children when my children know that they're not poor. And in my case, I loved going to a university. I thought it was wonderful going to a university. It was better than heavy lifting. It was better than working in the mills or the mines, which was the alternative. My children are in a different position. They hate going to the university. They have to. They have no choice. But they don't react in the same way. I don't mean they hate it. But for them, it's not a liberation. It's a duty. Everybody has to do it. It's a totally different experience for them. So it's difficult to bring up children for liberty. But this opens up a great opportunity for poor people. Because what in a free society, there is a circulation of elites. Formerly poor people often become the best industrialists, the best inventors, the best surgeons, the best brain doctors, whatever. You never know. And that's, I think, a merit of the free society. And finally, the third point I said I wanted to mention, which is not usually made, is that capitalism is essentially about the mind. It's about the spirit. It requires more self-discipline, more self-denial than socialism or the third world or pre-capitalist alternative. My Italian friend said he went to America to make money, to work. And he came back to Italy to live. Now that's pre-capitalist liberty. That's the Italy of the 1940s and 50s. When most people work in agriculture. Today in Italy, they work as fast as in America. Of the 10 economic regions of Europe that were the most creative and most dynamic and most showed most growth in the last year, 4 were in Italy. The Italians have become one of the first capitalist nations of Europe. With much more enterprise, discovery, sense of design, sense of originality, much more mind-oriented than their neighbors. It's a great story, actually. I think I've made my 3 points at least a little bit clear, and I'll just stop for questions and discussions. I can understand Spanish. I cannot speak it, but I will understand much of what you say in Spanish, so you can ask questions. Either in Spanish or in English.
Gracias, Michael. No sé si está ahí Héctor con el micrófono. ¿O alguien está en el micrófono? Bien, ahora comenzamos entonces una sesión de preguntas del público. Voy a partir por una de la mesa. En general, en la doctrina social, el término justicia social está vinculado el término de justicia social, decía, a la cuestión de la distribución de la riqueza. De una u otra manera, el término apunta a una mayor justicia en la distribución de la riqueza. ¿La definición que usted propone recoge algo de esta dimensión o significa un nuevo sentido al término justicia social que no tiene raíces en lo que ha sido hasta ahora el uso de ese término en la doctrina social de la Iglesia?
Well, I didn't take him off. If you test the definition I give to social justice with every sentence of the Pope's, it fits. In fact, it makes more clear what the Popes are trying to say. And it explains why the Popes continue to talk of social justice as a virtue. And if you supply the virtue of forming associations to solve social problems, you also give what is implicit in that text. And what is their alternative to socialism? So I think I have done three useful things. I've given a solid definition of the term, which otherwise you won't find. There's a whole book on social justice, Calvez and Perrin, two French writers. A whole book. There's no definition of social justice in the book. And that's true of virtually everybody you read. In the Catholic Encyclopedia after Vatican II, Sacramentum Mundi, there is no entry under social justice. It's a concept everybody takes for granted and everybody uses, but nobody defines. I have given it a definition which fits every statement of the Pope's, which addresses every problem the Pope solved. I've explained, secondly, why it came into existence when it did, and what need it filled, and I've given it a very practical usage. So I offer it as a theory about social justice, and so far I've heard words of gratitude for it, and I have not heard it refuted. So I think it's very useful. And it is also a definition of social justice that fits very well the needs of the free society. And the main narrative line of the 20th century, as Pope John Paul II says, is the story of liberty. This definition fits that story. And in Poland, I can tell you, this is exactly what many young Catholics are doing. They notice problems in Poland that create injustices, and they try to organize groups to solve them. They don't want to turn to government. They had that for 40 years. They want to solve problems through civil society. So I know young people are doing this everywhere. And I think it's a practical. But it is for you to judge. I mean, a book can make an argument, it's for readers to decide.
Gracias, Michael. Hay una pregunta. Supongo que las preguntas sean preguntas y sean breves.
Any proposition to solve the problem?
Yes, that's a problem which happens all the time. You can observe that when people speak of the common good, they are always speaking about the common good as they see it. And as it happens, it always turns out that the common good serves their own interests. I will give you a very clear example. In America 3 weeks ago, the Catholic bishops wrote a document for the common good, they said, on welfare reform. And they essentially gave an argument, which is the argument of the Democratic Party. Yes, we want reform, but no, we don't want this reform that the Congress has come up with. And the main outline of the reform the Congress has come up with is to take, when we say welfare in the United States, we mean only one thing. We mean the benefits for single women with children. That's different from the way the word is used in Europe. For old people, we talk about Social Security. For medical care, we talk about Medicaid for the poor, Medicare for the elderly. Welfare means precisely support for single women with children. That is now 30% of the children born in America are born outside of marriage. And that doesn't mean that the couple lives together but they're not married. Almost always it means the father is gone. And he's probably having children by other women. Often 3 or 4 other women. And taking responsibility from them. Now, the main proposal of the Republicans is that welfare spending should be allowed to programs invented by the states. You should defederalize it, take it out of the control of the central government, and give it back to the states. I would think that's an exercise of the principle of subsidiarity, Catholic principle. Problems should be solved on the level closest to them. There's a strong argument for this. Why? Of the cases of single mothers with children, 10 states have 60% of the caseload. The other 40 states have the other 40%, whether it's average 1% apiece. So it's a problem of great disparity. The cases are concentrated in 10 states. Take Massachusetts. It has 230,000 some cases of women, single women with children. New Hampshire, right next door, has 23,000 cases. New Hampshire is easy to solve. Every church in New Hampshire could adopt one woman and help her. Or every business could promise to hire one woman and help her. In Massachusetts, that's impossible. There are too many. Why should the program be run from one office in Washington, making rules that apply equally to every state? It's contrary to the principle of subsidiarity, and it is inherently irrational. So I would think the strongest argument is the Republican argument, from a Catholic point of view. The bishops say they are speaking for the common good, but they don't even get the Republican argument. They just reject it. They don't argue against it. They repeat the Democratic argument, that it will be better for children if it stays in the federal level. Why? It's the federal level that created this problem. We never had so many children born out of wedlock before. Before we had welfare, 5% of children were born out of wedlock. Today, with welfare, to help families, to strengthen the family, we have 30%. But don't the bishops understand that 30 years ago, when they urged us to adopt welfare, the problem was minuscule. And they didn't tell us we would have a 600% increase before they were out of wedlock, but we did. So why are they saying this is for the common good? It's manifestly not for the common good. But remember this, how is the money distributed to mothers? Frequently through the churches. And you can't help seeing an interest between the Catholic Church's charity program and the federal government. So they say they are speaking for the common good, but it happens also to be in the interest of the church that these programs come from the federal level. So, my proposal, you asked what is my proposal. My proposal is if Catholics or any other group see something going wrong in society, for example, in a free society, maybe people won't make provision for disabled people. Maybe they'll be not. Well then, Christians and Jews and humanists say, disabled people have human dignity. We must do something to help them. It offends the judgment of a free society to let the most vulnerable suffer. So we will start a movement to help disabled people. That's the way you, where there's a social injustice, you organize to correct it. Either by persuading the government to do something, or better, by working out a way for private people to do it. And there are always things to be done. Every society needs reform. So there'll be no end to social justice. And we'll never reach a point where we can say that you don't need social justice anymore, folks. There's nothing more to do. You'll never get there.
Profesor Novak, yo pertenezco a una tradición. Yo fui educado en un colegio católico y yo tengo la impresión de que en la formación que yo recibí, la justicia social se identifica con la justicia distributiva. La idea que yo me hago de lo que piensa la Iglesia acerca de justicia es que sigue un argumento tradicional, que justicia dan a cada cual lo suyo, y que el hábito que nos hace justo es justamente atribuirle a nuestro prójimo, a cada cual, lo que es suyo. Y también, ¿verdad?, atribuirle a la comunidad lo que le es debido. Contribuir para su defensa, contribuir para que exista justicia o poder jurisdiccional, para que existan legisladores, etc. Pero también tengo la impresión que se desprende del pensamiento de Tomás de Aquino y de Aristóteles. Y también tengo la impresión que se desprende del pensamiento de Tomás de Aquino y de Aristóteles, que hay una justicia que se ejercida por la comunidad como tal, es decir, la comunidad organizada políticamente, y que esa es la justicia distributiva. ¿Qué lugar tiene este concepto de justicia distributiva en la concepción que usted nos da de justicia social? Entendiendo, digamos, que ella es social, como usted lo acaba de decir, porque se refiere a problemas que hay en la sociedad y porque nos incita a asociarnos para enfrentarlos. ¿No es eso un criterio reductivamente individualista y fundado solo en el derecho de asociación que ejercemos dentro de los países que son democráticos? Me parece que hay allí un contrapunto, una cuestión que puede ser disputada desde el punto de vista de lo que piensa la Iglesia tradicionalmente sobre la justicia social.
You learned your lessons well in school. Mostly when the clergy particularly talk about social justice, they immediately begin talking about distributive justice. Second, they immediately think of a state program, politically organized. And thirdly, they mean taking away from rich and middle class people and giving to the poor. That's what they say. But let's look at what happened in the real world. First of all, the term social justice in the encyclicals does not mean distributive justice. If they wanted to talk about distributive justice, they could talk about that. That's a concept, well established. Social justice is supposed to be adding something new. If it's reducible to distributive justice, you take the novelty out of it. Second, under the concept of social justice, as I have described it, it may well be that citizens will decide the best way to meet, to solve the problem is to use the state. There are places where you turn to the state. To keep law and order, for example, in the American West, where there was no state, it was important to bring in the law, to form government, and not to have vigilante justice. There's a clear example of where you need to stay. There may also be some problems for elderly people or poor people or something where, for various reasons, the state solution is more practical. And that's one option for social justice. But it would always come from people organizing themselves to diagnose the problem and to support an action in that area. preferably their own action, but if necessary, the state action. That's according to the principle of subsidiarity too. We turn to the state as the last resort. Especially in times of flood, or hurricane, or war, or disaster, people turn to the state for emergency assistance, as well as volunteers. Volunteers show up by hundreds in our country, and I think in Chile. But at the same time, you need the state organization too. But I will go back to a point I made earlier. If you look at what has happened in the welfare states, which interpret social justice as distributive justice, every one of them has become corrupt. In Italy, in the Netherlands, in Germany, the number of people who seek benefits for disabilities has reached historic highs. And you can only get disability payment if you have a letter from your doctor. Well, doctors feel they have to sign. They don't believe you really have a disability. They realize it's a political act. You need a piece of paper to get the money. The government offers the money, why shouldn't you get it? And so doctors lie. And wherever you have the state trying to do distributive justice, you have an increase in dependency, an increase in reliance on the state, more ingratitude, because no one is ever grateful that the government gives it. They only want more. And you have growing cynicism because there's corruption. The mafia in southern Italy controls the welfare system. And you will not get your benefits unless you cooperate with the mafia. It's a perfect instrument for governmental control, government benefits. It's a perfect instrument for corruption. There's no control on the expenditures. The wallet of the state is open. It's extremely punitive to the people who are productive, who are the only ones who pay for this. The result in Germany and in Italy and other places is that new entrepreneurs are discouraged because a distributed package is built into every job. When you hire someone, you're committed to them for life, to pay benefits of many kinds and taxes. So people don't hire unless they really have to. And they don't want to start new businesses because it's already risky. And if they have to pay the social package, they may destroy themselves. So if you look at every welfare state, everyone is in crisis, a budgetary crisis and a moral crisis. And in everyone, the number of females with dependent children is growing, single females. In Sweden, the rate is 60%. In the United States, it's 30%. In Britain, it's 33%. It started later, it's gone faster. In Chile, I think it's 30%. In Germany, it's 15%, which is incredible, unparalleled in history. For these reasons, there needs to be a critique of the 20th century ideas of distributive justice. They have done very much damage and some good, and very much damage. It cannot be the only solution to social justice.
Yo quería preguntarle, sabiendo que una de las formas más importantes de asociación que existen son los sindicatos. Y en este momento en el país hay problemas, en el fondo se cuestiona mucho las reformas laborales que se están planteando en este minuto en el Congreso. Yo quería preguntarle cómo cree usted que se puede compatibilizar las exigencias de los trabajadores, por un lado, con las líneas trazadas por una empresa, en el sentido de que siempre han sido roces y dentro obviamente del marco que se puede plantear.
In 1891, many bishops, especially from Europe, wanted Pope Leo XIII to condemn the unions because the unions were typically socialist or communist. But the American bishops saw that in the United States, many Catholic workers, most Catholics were workers, they didn't own businesses, they were immigrants, belonged to unions. And they also remained in the church. And so the Catholic bishops made a very strong argument to Leo XIII to change his mind and to defend unity, which he did. And many people think that was the first contribution from the Americas to the social doctrine of the church, was to defend unity. And labor unions have traditionally been treated as one of the most important forms of association we have. Today, however, there is a crisis in the labor unions. Independently of their problems with management or corporations, there's a crisis for the corporations too. It's worldwide competition. In the United States, we once had three giant automobile companies, Ford, Chrysler, General Motors. But today we have about eight, Toyota, Nissan, Volkswagen, Saab, Volvo, and Daewon. Two different Korean companies. And they are taking business. So a very intelligent man I know in Florida has come up with a new idea. He suggests that labor unions, especially in the manufacturing and service areas, should become corporations and offer their workers on contract to companies on a temporary or long-term basis. And they could capitalize the pension funds of their workers as part of their capital. We call it ESOP, Employee Stock Option Companies, Stock Ownership Companies. And the law protects that. So insofar as a company contributes to a pension of a worker, it would contribute to the union's pension fund. And then the union could send, let's say it's a telecommunications union, it could send so many workers this year to AT&T, or Florida Bell, whatever they call it. And then next year, they would form a new contract. And meanwhile, they could hire out the same workers to television companies or to anybody, a satellite company, anybody in the television field. Why? I heard Rocco Buttiglione, the head of the Christian Democratic Union in Italy, explain it this way. In Italy, we have become used to thinking of a job as a right, a lifetime guarantee package. So that no longer exists. Companies are fighting for their survival. What we need to do is think about work in a new way. We should think about work as so many work opportunities. How many work opportunities does Italy have? He said we have many more work opportunities than we have workers, but they are not permanent. Some are for 6 months, some are for 6 years, some are for 16 years. We will not be able to guarantee life. But we will be able to promise, not guarantee, but promise, a government that favors new job opportunities. So that there will always be more work than there are workers, but it will not always be the same work. It's a new way of thinking. And labor unions will have to find a new design of association to meet the changing economic environment. I don't know what the answer is. I know that labor unions are very important. They're a school of democracy. In the war against communism, they were one of the most effective organizations in every part of the world. They're one of the main teachers of democracy to often poor and uneducated people. So they're a crucial institution. But the form in which they have solidified in the industrial age may not be appropriate to the economic age. And we used to have intellectuals who thought about labor very creatively. Today, the intellectuals have abandoned labor. Today, the intellectuals in our country, at least, are more interested in Hollywood and the universities than in labor. Labor is low class. They prefer to be with Shirley MacLaine, Sharon Stone, and turn their political views.
Hay una pregunta al fondo, la última, y a la izquierda.
No, no es pregunta, es... I don't know if you follow me, I speak English or Spanish, as you choose.
It is more interesting if you speak Spanish, okay. Because then I learned something.
El problema es el siguiente, para ir a lo más concreto después. Hay dos visiones culturales entre el caso de Estados Unidos y los países católicos en los cuales está Chile, lo cual hace muy difícil, pero muy difícil el diálogo. Y me voy a explicar. La visión cultural de los países católicos es que la comunidad es más importante que el individuo. En el caso de la Iglesia Católica, existen fenómenos como la excomunión, como la expulsión de una persona si no sigue las reglas de la Iglesia. Un cristiano se salva en la medida en que cumple las reglas de la Iglesia. El caso de Estados Unidos es un caso especialmente atípico. Y Estados Unidos es el caso único en el mundo de una cultura que rompe con la idea social, toda la idea de los peregrinos, la formación de la sociedad de Estados Unidos. Parte del principio que el individuo es más que la sociedad. Y esto se expresa obviamente en la concepción del Estado. La idea del Estado en los países europeos continentales es muy distinta a la idea del Estado en Estados Unidos y es muy distinta a la idea del Estado en Chile. En nuestros países, el Estado tiene no solamente la obligación de dirigir al país, sino también de preservar la comunidad. Y eso implica también obligaciones del Estado. En el caso de Estados Unidos, la imagen típica del Estado es vista como algo, como un mal necesario, algo eminentemente corruptible, pero que existe porque si no, no hay gobierno. En nuestra cultura, el Estado tiene un papel de integrador. Y estoy resumiendo, pero al máximo. Esto daría origen a un debate muy, muy largo. Incluso hay palabras que son interesantes. Usted dijo que la palabra compromise no existe en castellano. Sí existe en castellano, pero se llama transacción. Y es interesante incluso el fondo de la diferencia. La transacción para nosotros es yo doy y tú me das. Es un acuerdo por el cual ambos ganan. La idea de compromiso tiene un concepto moral en el cual uno renuncia a otra cosa en pos de un bien mayor. Entonces, ¿cuál es el problema de fondo? Hay una diferencia cultural e histórica muy grande entre Estados Unidos y los países latinoamericanos. Entonces, cuando hablamos de justicia social, es obvio que estamos hablando de cosas radicalmente distintas. Radicalmente distintas. Y digo, lamentablemente el tiempo es corto, esto requeriría, ojalá que usted viniera más tiempo para acá, tuviéramos un... No, no, solamente en serio, no es broma. Porque lo que yo muchas veces lamento en el diálogo con mis amigos norteamericanos es que la gente que ha estado en Estados Unidos, como es el caso que hablo, entiende la cultura de Estados Unidos. Pero ahora que estamos hablando de una comunidad hemisférica, de NAFTA y todas esas cosas tan bonitas, hace falta que también de allá entiendan la cultura latinoamericana, que es distinto, que es distinto. Entonces, es un diálogo que es bastante más largo. Y la justicia social, como la idea del Estado, y la idea de la política, y la idea de los partidos, estamos hablando de conceptos, palabras iguales y conceptos distintos. Y eso es muy difícil discutir. En todo caso, yo felicito al profesor Nova por haber venido y por aportarnos una visión que es importante que la conozcamos los chilenos si queremos negociar con los norteamericanos, porque además del intercambio de productos hay también el momento clave de hacer el contrato y las palabras son muy importantes para entender conceptos comunes.
Well, I think you make a very important point about which I have tried to write quite often. It was my happy circumstance first to study theology in Italy, not in America, and to see the difference. For example, getting on a bus is a totally different experience in Rome from London. In London, everybody talks about the individual. But when it comes to daily transactions, like getting on a bus, everybody thinks first of the community. And they form up in a queue out of respect to the community, for the law. They have internalized social order. In fact, the British are so social that they need to emphasize the individual. It seems to me. The reverse is true in Italy. In Italy, everybody talks about comunità. But getting on a bus in Rome is one of the purest experiences of laissez-faire I've ever encountered. It is every man for himself. It is also one of the most sensuous experiences I've ever encountered. When I went to Rome, I thought the word lamentare meant blow your horn, because near the seminary where I was, there was an aqueduct, and it had a very narrow archway. The road was wider, and you had to go narrower to go through the archway. So they had the sign, said voluntary, and I observed what people did. They blew their horn and went faster. And really, when I discovered that the word voluntary means to go slow, it was with amazement. It never happened. Furthermore, I learned that in Rome, when there are laws of the church that you must always use wax candles and never use lights, those laws were better observed the farther away from Rome you were. The closer to Rome, the less they were observed. So I observed there is a theological difference between what people speak about and how people act. I would say it's much the same about Latin America. In Latin America, there's much talk about community, solidarity, social sense, but when you watch people behave, they behave more against the law and contrary to the law than they do in North America. Presenting an individual personal figura is much more important, it seems to me, to the Spanish male than anything talked about in the language. I have a Novak's maxim, or Novak's theorem. The theological language is always inverse to behavior. Theologically, you're always most preoccupied with the thing you do worst. And that's, I really believe that. I think there's a stronger social sense in North America than there is in Latin America. In Latin America, in business and in many things, it's every man for himself. We believe in the rules of the game. When you're young, you're taught to obey the rules. And for the most part, people, sometimes they break them, obviously. But for the most part, there's less corruption and more honesty. Out of people who talk a lot about the individual. And in fact, we are such conformists. I had a friend who's from the State Department, whose assignment, he was attached to a university, but his assignment was taking Soviet communists, visitors through America. And how do you know in the bad days, when they came, they were all KGB. You know that to begin with. But it was interesting. He would take them around to different cities. And at the end of it, one of them said to him, "You know what's most amazing in America? How much the same you all are. You eat the same food. Everybody has Heinz ketchup. You wear clothes from the same factories. You find the same automobiles all around the country. You all conform. If a policeman comes along and says, stay off the grass, you all move off the grass." He said, well, he didn't say, once I was with a Latin American, I won't say which country, in the Central Park in New York, and a policeman came along and broke, we were playing guitars, I was young, we were singing, it was romantic, we weren't doing any harm, but there's a rule, you're not supposed to be in the grass. And one policeman came along and said, all right now, everybody off the grass. And my friend from Latin America was amazed, because 300 Americans got up and moved. He said, look at those stones. He said, in my country, he said, we were all dug out stones. He said, one policeman would never move us. Well, anyway, my Russian visitor said, for 70 years in the Soviet Union, you've been trying to make people uniform. We cannot do it. How did you succeed? So we would need many hours to talk about the social sense in Germany. Bishop von Kempler, the founder of social doctrine in Germany, and the main influence on the Pope, has an essay on the German character. And he says, from the most ancient days, the greatest virtue of the Germans as warriors was solidarity. We always fought together and we acted together. And the individual always fought first to the tribe. That's very deep. The separation of Germany between the East and West was psychically extremely painful to the Germans, much more than to any other people that I know. The sense of disunity offended the deep German sense of solidarismus. But please, solidarismus is very dangerous. Hitler made great use of it. The goose step was designed to dramatize it, to make a sound all at once in unison, as long as the sight of those, it's a very impractical way to march, except that it creates terror. And it's terror of the unbroken ranks. So, may I point out lastly, that if you look at definitions of the common good over history, in the last century, more and more definitions of the common good have said what the Second Vatican Council said. Namely, I can't remember it word for word, but the basic idea is that the common good is the whole of all those goods which serve the welfare of the community and the fulfillment of every individual person. It's that last phrase which is new. You don't find that in Aristotle. You don't find it even in Aquinas. It's a modern definition of the common good. The common good is not the common good if one single person is abused or oppressed, then the common good has not been reached. The common good includes the fulfillment of every individual person. Now, I think in the United States we are much more social-minded than our European friends or our Latin American friends see. Our favorite sports are not sports of the individual, they are team sports. The Holy Trinity, baseball, basketball, football. The great experience of American males are communitarian. That is, you have to play them as a team. No one wins a game alone. I think we are the most social-minded people on earth. Our whole life is social. We are always working with others. The only place I am alone is on the airplane. After the first conversation with the passenger next to me, they always ask me, "What do you do?" And I always answer, "I teach." And they say, "Oh?" They all have bad memories of school. They mostly quit right there. They don't bother me anymore. And some of them ask me another question. They persistently say, "What do you teach?" And I say, "Humanities." And they say, "Oh?" And they're silent. They don't bother me the rest of the time. No phones ring, no committee meetings. It's the only time I am alone. I spend the rest of my life in committee meetings. In a democratic capitalist system, you're always with other people. The only job you can do that you work alone is be a professor of literature. In sociology, physics, everything else, you work in teams. The last Lone Rangers in America are literature. So I think the ordinary way that community is discussed and the individual discussed is inadequate. It does not meet experience. Therefore, I think you have raised the most important subject and the most important obstacle to Catholic social thought. Many people interpret Catholic social thought in tribal terms. And Catholicism is not about tribes. It is about a community whose main purpose is the salvation of persons, each one of whom has to make the act of faith alone, for himself or herself, has to appropriate the faith, make the faith their own. It's a different form of community from any pagan community, the community of any other religion. It gives more dignity to each person than any other religion. You must not make Catholicism tribal. You must not interpret Catholic social thought as the ideology of social democracy. It is not an ideology. It is a reflection on a unique faith which values both the community and the individual person as God does. God knows the name of every person, and he speaks the name of every person. It's true he wants us all to be in community. We are a community of persons of God. But it is our individuality that makes us different from cats, or dogs, or trees, cows, bees, swarms of bees, or herds of cattle, or anthills. Human beings, Majak Mayantan said, the most beautiful thing in the world, the most beautiful thing God created is the human person. More beautiful than all the stars. It requires changes in Catholic traditional life to realize a society like that. It requires, I'm not saying the North Americans have done it, we have many, many faults. We are very far from the kingdom of God, very far indeed. You know, Madonna is not the kingdom of God, believe me. And O.J. Simpson, etc. And our politics, the crime, there are many, many things wrong. But there are some ways in which, as Pope John Paul II said on his visit, the distinctively American contribution to Catholic social thought is a new idea of liberty. Ordered liberty is the phrase for it. The phrase comes from Lord Acton. It is the liberty, the Pope said these exact words, true liberty is not the liberty to do what you want, whatever you feel like. Liberty is to do what you ought to do. Human beings are the only creatures that are free to do our duty or not to do it. We have two cats at home. They cannot do anything but obey the law of their nature. They just behave. They do what cats always do. They frisk, they fight, they're hungry, they want to go to the bathroom, whatever. But they just behave. Our children are constantly acting. They're thinking of new things. Maybe according to the law of their nature, maybe against the law of their nature. But they have trouble finding the law of their nature. It's not clear to the human beings. We're a complicated animal. Now, it's almost time to conclude, but this is maybe a good story. The French were the first Europeans to understand North America and the difference. And the French liberals, led by Tocqueville and de Rochefoucauld, wanted to celebrate the novel idea of liberty represented in the Americas and not in Europe. Not the liberté of the French Revolution, whose symbol was the prostitute on the altar of Notre Dame. Do whatever you feel like. That's Madonna, too. There are Americans who hold that view, but it's not the genuine view. And so they wanted to build a monument to this new idea of liberty. They didn't know what to do. Should they build a pyramid? Should they build another Eiffel Tower? So they did what all free people do. They formed a committee. But it was a committee of Frenchmen. So it became instantly clear that they should make a statue of a woman. No discussion. I'm not kidding. I mean, I was at the 100th anniversary of 1986 in Paris and in New York at the celebration of this Statue of Liberty, which they made. And I gave this little story, and one of the descendants of the Rochefoucauld said, "You're exactly right. That's exactly what happened." Because in French iconography, the symbol of liberty is always a woman. Flowing white robes, carrying the banners. In Russia and almost everywhere else, in Nicaragua, it's a young male, it's not a woman, it's a male with a collection of on a battlement. But the French immediately, it's a figure of a woman. Woman since the 5th century is the symbol of liberty. Sophia is a woman, a philosophy. So liberty is a woman. But what a woman? She has in one arm that lights the lamp against the fog and mist of ignorance and passion and bigotry. So it's liberty under reason, liberty under life. Not what you wish, not what you want, not what you feel like, but what reason tells you. And in her other arm, she has the book of the law, liberty under the law. So it's liberty under reason and liberty under the law. There's an American hymn, you must have heard it in America because they sing it often at football games and so on. One line of it goes, it's America the Beautiful, and one line of it goes, confirm thy soul in self-control by liberty and law. In America, liberty and law are friends. One, you must have one to have the other. You can't have the one without the other, as the song is. It's very different from in Italy. Liberty is whatever the law doesn't permit. I mean, you do. It's different from the law. It's outside the law. I went to a little restaurant, Via Margherita, the old 1920s hangout of American artists. And I was starting. I ordered pasta, and he said, "What do you want on it?" I said, "Sugo, meat sauce." And he said. And he started to go, and I said, it's Friday. I said, I better not do that, just tomatoes. And he said, he looked at me, and he said, my friend, he said, the Pope is right over there, he said. We know the Pope. We've been with the Pope for hundreds of years. He doesn't care if you eat meat. It's perfectly all right. The moment you can eat meat, he said. I understood something all of a sudden about the different meaning of law and liberty. In America, the idea is you must internalize liberty. You must internalize the law. You must internalize peace. Then you can follow your instincts. But only then. Just to do what you feel like, just to react with passion, is to be uninfected, to be not sober, to be not deliberate, to be adolescent, to be not quite mature. Now, I'll give you another example. It works funny in the opposite. In America, there's a huge traffic jam and you cannot move, and Americans are trying to retain their self-control, and you can imagine them sitting in their automobiles listening to their stomach juices drip. In Italy, you come to a traffic jam, people get out of their cars, they yell, they scream, there's 60 different words for stupid, they get in fights, but nobody ever lands a blow, you know, and they get out of their system. And it's a very different way of handling passion. It's a very different model of what it is to be mature, of what it is to be self-controlled. It's just very different. These cultural differences must not be allowed to preempt Catholic social thought. Catholic social thought is meant to be a universal teaching, applicable to all peoples, and learning lessons from each people who made a contribution to it. So, again, I think the question you raised about the meaning of person and individual is very important. There's a good deal on this subject in this book. There's a lot in the spirit of democratic capitalism. There's even more in the little book I wrote about Latin America called This Hemisphere of Liberty, on misunderstandings between North and South America. I'm not sure I understand all of them, but I know they exist. The English say, the Americans and the English misunderstand each other in the same language. And I would say the North Americans and the Latin Americans misunderstand each other in different languages. But neither one should be the only model for Catholic social thought. And that's why we need intellectual people need constantly to reflect on it, and to distinguish it from tribal or ideological meanings, and form meanings from it that are applicable at all around the world.
En la encíclica Laudem Excelsa de Juan Pablo II,
un momento, perdón.
Él hace especial hincapié, y creo que es la encíclica de la Iglesia donde más se destaca el valor subjetivo del trabajo como base fundamental de la nobleza y dignidad del hombre. Entonces, al concebirse esta virtud de cumplir las leyes sociales, o de la virtud social que usted señala, que yo la comparto plenamente, debería tal vez estar implícito la obligación moral de calificar a cada persona en su momento y con sus circunstancias ante el problema de justicia que se le plantea. Esa es la preocupación que yo les pongo.
¿Puedes repetir la pregunta?
Quisiera yo saber si acaso dentro de este concepto de la virtud social que usted ha destacado, debería esta virtud comprender la calificación de cada persona, no solo de los grupos, sino de cada individuo, en el momento en que está aportando un trabajo. Ese trabajo no solo tiene un valor objetivo, sino que un valor subjetivo, dependiendo de la persona que lo hace y de sus circunstancias.
Yes, I think
it's
sorry.
Yes, I think in fact for many Christians, their work, their daily work, is one of the fundamental ways in which they serve the community, and they take pleasure in it. I have met waitresses who believe their vocation is to be a waitress, and they try to make life a little more pleasant for everybody who comes. They are Christians, and they believe that to spread community and to spread a little bit of the joy of Christ, they should put into their work. So their work has meaning to them. It's not just lifting dishes and plates. It is an act, a conscious Christian act. And there are people who work in factories who will never see the people who will use the items they make. They may be assembling a television set. But they take great pride in doing it exactly, in making sure every piece they handle, every connection they make is well made, so that people will have satisfaction from it. And when they leave their work at night, They like to think we make the here in this factory, we make the best television system in the world. I read just the other day, I was reading a book about Pittsburgh, which is my own, close to my own hometown in Pennsylvania. And I was reading a story about the closing of the steel mills about 10, 15 years ago. And one of the workers were all, they went to one of the taverns after work, and they were all crying and unhappy about the closing of these mills, as you can understand. They had worked there for years. But one of them said, you know, asking everybody to drink a toast, "We made the best damn steel in the world, and they can't take that from us." I think that's the common feeling when people work. Well, let me put it this way. Where that is a common feeling, you get a much higher level of work. And any good executive tries to inspire these people to treat their work that way, and treat them in a way that is commensurate with that. So I agree thoroughly that the way we approach our jobs is part of the work of social justice. And the fundamental part, because that's what we do for 8 hours a day at least. The rest is typically outside our work, that's important too. We have responsibilities outside our work. But the first work of social justice is our work. And I repeat what the Pope said because it was so important. He said, the communists claim to speak for the workers. But when they analyze work, all they talk about is the quantity. This factory must produce so many television sets this year. Faster, better, etc. But then, the sets are so badly made that nobody wants to buy them. And they sit outside and they rust. And so the workers come to work, seeing the sets they worked on last week, sitting outside going nowhere. And it destroys their morale, because the Pope said, you have to remember that a worker puts subjective value into their work. Work is not just objective quantities. It carries a person's concern and care and dedication in it. And so to treat the work without any way to market it is an insult to the worker. And he embarrassed the Marxists because he took their word, work, and turned it inside out, made it a Christian word. And it immediately touched everybody in Poland because they understood the difference. So, you know, 30% of the crop rotted in the fields because the distribution system didn't work. Fish were caught. Men caught pneumonia catching the fish on the Bering Sea in the winter. And then the refrigeration units wouldn't work. The fish would go corrupt and rot. So, again, I repeat that anything that insults the subjective value that the worker puts into his work is an insult to the worker. And that shows it is a work of social justice. The worker is working for the good of the human community.
Gracias. Mi pregunta tiene que ver con el concepto de libertad. Te partió su intervención mencionando la libertad. Tenemos tres vertientes: la política, la económica y la moral y cultural. En este país hemos llevado mucho tiempo discutiendo acerca de la libertad económica, la libertad política, y yo diría que estamos bastante maduros producto de la discusión permanente acerca del tema. Creo que la discusión para adelante viene qué libertad cultural, moral, vamos a discutir de aquí para adelante. Pero mi pregunta es, ¿cuál es el concepto de libertad que permite tener una interpretación coherente? Que sea el mismo concepto de libertad en lo político, en lo económico, en lo cultural y moral, si eso existe. Porque distintos conceptos de libertad, como ciencia de coacción, porque mi libertad termina cuando empieza la de los demás. Pero al final, a mí me da la impresión, y en su mensaje está, que el fundamento de la libertad está en la profunda creencia de la capacidad del hombre de poder determinar su destino. Y eso se da en la política, se da en la parte económica. No sé si en la parte cultural. La posición católica piensa igual, porque muchas veces uno escucha de que es más conveniente más restricciones y una suerte más de menos confianza en el individuo y más instituciones que controlen o no liberalicen todo el tema cultural moral, por ejemplo, a restricciones o censura a la televisión. Una creencia de que hay una comisión
un organismo con capacidad de coacción que determina mejor que las personas qué es lo que se puede ver o no se puede ver. Entonces la duda mía está en ese concepto de libertad.
Muchas gracias. I had to choose what to talk about in 1.5 hour. It was a professor's definition of 1.5 hour, it was more like 50 minutes. I said yesterday, professors only have 50-minute thoughts, so when I'm assigned a 1/2 hour, you have to watch out. But what I thought I might talk about is the subject you now bring up. So you give me an opportunity to address. In the 20th century, by and large, the world has learned that the hypothesis that in the political order, dictatorship is better for people. When I first came to Chile, I heard people argue that. But it was widely argued in the 20th century. Even many Catholics, like Emmanuel Mounier and others, were so anti-liberal that they supported the Vichy government, and they in effect supported Hitler in the early years. Much to the disgrace of social Catholicism in France, and to the disgrace of personalism in its early years. And secondly, the world has learned that the great economic question, capitalism or socialism, has been resolved in favor of capitalism. Socialism does not work. It is very bad for poor people, very bad for the society. But the great question that's unanswered is, how ought we to live? It's the moral question. It's the religious question. How should we use our liberty? I believe that's becoming, in every country, it is in our own country, I think it is in Chile, I think, it's becoming the most pressing political problem. It's the unsolved problem of the 20th century is how ought free men and free women to act? How should we think? What should we favor? What should we try to hold back to restrain? And if we want to restrain, how should we do it? In America, there's widespread, in North America, in the United States, there's widespread consensus, not universal, but widespread, that American television is a disgrace. That Hollywood is a disgrace. That it spews out values and images that are contrary to all the best things in American life. And that are evil and corrupt people, corrupt their souls. So how do you correct this? I have some friends who argue we need more censorship. There should be much less violence on television. And it should be censored. There should be set up a board, one way or the other. There's lots of ways to do it, which simply prohibits the degree of violence that there is. There's too much of it. And there are other people who think that we must set up similar boards to control the sexual, what can I say? It's sexual nihilism. It is purposeless and tasteless and so forth. Its purpose is to shock. And unfortunately, people get accustomed to it, and then you have to do something worse to shock them. And it's a downhill slope. It just gets worse and worse and worse. Fortunately, those movies don't sell very well. And to the truth is, all the great new, quote, artistic movies, they have poor sales. And the movies which have the great sales are the Disney films and others that grandparents want to take the grandchildren to and the whole family goes to. Those have the biggest sales. But unfortunately, Hollywood is not ruled by money, it's ruled by ideology. And the movie makers prefer to win the esteem of their colleagues, even if their movies don't make money. In some inverted way, they find prestige in them. They're too good for the people to appreciate. Look, there's another way to handle it. And that is laughter, and irony, and satire. If the intellectuals of America and the editorial writers greeted every new pornographic movie, and most of them are pornographic for at least 2 or 3 minutes. It's a mandatory pornographic episode for most of them. Sometimes it's not pornographic, it's just too explicit. If the editorialists and the intellectuals and the professors and the artists laughed, they said, this is adolescent. I mean, adolescents want to see more nudity and so on and so forth, but adults, I mean, really. it would change. In other words, you don't need government controls if civil society works. If decent people laugh and make satirical comments, nobody likes to be laughed at. The most powerful weapon in the world is the raised eyebrow. You know, when the Pope sits down to make a decision, remember when Pope Paul VI called a commission to report on whether to maintain Catholic teaching on contraception or not? And the commission, the majority part of the commission said no, the Catholic Church should permit contraception. And the minority part said, yes, the Catholic Church should keep its old teaching. The minority came out in favor of the old teaching. The Pope decided with the minority. But a friend of mine said, what's the last thing he thought of as he was about to make this decision? He had to go public and say something. What's the last thing he thought about? My friend says, what he thought about is, what would my mother say? Would my mother raise her eyebrow? It's the most powerful weapon in the world. If there's somebody you respect, and you go to them with some new idea, and they don't tell you it's wrong, they just raise their eyebrows and look at you like you're crazy, that kills it for many people. But if you're asking the judgment of the people whose judgment you trust most. So I'm saying if there were more raised eyebrows in public, especially among the intellectuals, this would stop. And I think the way to make that argument is as follows. To have a free society, you've got to have responsible people who are able to make deliberate, reflective decisions, who do not follow passion, but train themselves to reflect first, count to 10, take a cold shower, and then make a decision. If you show this sexual seduction all the time, you're going to create a population that doesn't think, that doesn't reflect, that reacts to sensual stimuli only. You're gonna debilitate the quality of reason that you have to have a free society. I think you can appeal to liberals, you can appeal to secularists, you can appeal to atheists and say, to be a serious, reflective, free person, you need to control your passions. And therefore, we must have movies which teach self-control, teach respect for woman, respect for man. I think the liberals have not made this argument for 100 years. Liberals have been so intent on fighting tradition, they have forgotten to defend their own virtues. I think you can embarrass liberals into coming to the defense of the family, coming to the defense of a proper understanding of sexuality, coming to a proper defense of chastity, a proper defense of fidelity. It's not just a Catholic idea, these ideas. They're universal. And they have philosophical reasons for it, not merely religious reasons for it. And that process has begun in the United States. I think we are at the beginning of what a professor from the University of Chicago calls the fourth great awakening. In America, we've had three great awakenings, meaning religious revivals, to keep the country on the right track. After the Revolutionary War, the War of Independence, at the end of the 18th century, 1776, 1781, for the next 30 years, there was an outbreak of disorder. The law was violated. There was more laws, the tremendous drinking, the consumption of alcohol per capita went to unprecedented levels. That invoked the Methodist revival, the temperance movement, the Sunday school movement. Within 40 years, more than two-thirds of every youngster age 16 were going to Sunday school. The consumption of alcohol went down to about one-third of what it was. Violent crime fell to unprecedented low point, where it stayed for 130 years. And beginning in the 1950s, it's a perfect new curve. High consumption of gin and other alcohol, crime, public drunkenness, lawlessness, then down from the Second Great Awakening to very low levels of violence, children born out of wedlock were under 5%. For 130 years, and then suddenly a sharp U rise at the other end, with television, with the new morality, with the elites becoming more and more anti-Christian, anti-Jewish. And so there's a revulsion against that. Even President Clinton has publicly criticized Hollywood, both from the right and from the left now. And I think there's a chance to restore the more traditional morality. It will take another generation But it will be done by persuasion, by ridicule, by laughter, by saying, that's not liberated, that's stupid. Again, I'm going to give you some examples. On our campuses, in the 1960s, there was tremendous movement to mix dormitories, men and women in the same dormitory. At first, they did it on separate floors. Now they don't even do that. But what was the effect? It turned out that in these dormitories, the mixed dormitories, the men began treating the women like their sisters. There was no dating, there was no romance. Everybody had their romances outside the dormitory. But at the same time, there was another thing happened. The idea went around that if a man or a woman does not have sex, then they're right. There's something wrong with them. There was a tremendous pressure to become involved before marriage without seriousness in a trivial way. And more women, particularly men too, started a movement against that. They wear a little flower or something signifying a commitment to chastity. And they had revolted against the sexual revolution. They argued for the right to say no. If I say no, I'm not neurotic. I mean no. That, you know, sexuality is, I'm going to speak in the way that kids do, is too good to waste. And it is better if you save it. And it is spreading. It's not helped by the elites, it's not helped by the professors, but it's being generated. There's a popular reaction. And the universities have begun to change their dormitory policy and other things as a consequence. So I am arguing there are three people have to take moral and religious responsibility too. We've allowed it to drift. We cannot depend merely on tradition, because tradition has proved a weak reed under the pressure of television and movies and elite opinion. We have to create new arguments for traditional values, new way of persuading people, and people are open to it. Complete permissiveness does not work. It does not make happier marriages. It does not make happier people. It does not work. And you can make the argument, and more people will hear it and accept it. But I want to thank you again, because I think the crucial question for the 21st century, suppose the whole world goes democratic. Suppose the whole world goes capitalist. What would it be worth if we lose our souls, to use the religious language? What if we gain the whole world and suffer the loss of your soul? Or let me put it in another language. What if we have democracy and we have capitalism and we have free institutions and then we live like pigs? What's the point? I mean, did people, so many people give their blood so that we could live like cats and dogs? It can't be true. We've got free institutions, we must live in a way worthy of them. And besides, if we don't live in a way worthy of them, we will lose them. If you have a jury, like in the O.J. Simpson case, where the jurors say he's not guilty, and then they come out, and three or four of them say, well, we think he was probably guilty, but for other reasons, we didn't want to convict O.J. for racial solidarity. You say to yourself, and American people say, how can we have a court system? If jurors will not follow the evidence and will not speak the truth, but give in to their feelings, nobody is safe. Do you want to be judged by 12 people who go by their feelings and not by the evidence? No. But that's where we're headed. In the moral decline, that's where we're heading. You cannot have free institutions if you cannot count on people to be responsible and obey the truth, no matter what their feelings. You've got to put aside your feelings and follow the truth in a jury, and in many other places. If you have corrupt judges and corrupt jurors, there's no hope. And if you have corrupt politicians, corrupt congressmen and senators, the public gets more cynical and then democracy falls apart. Why bother? It's too cumbersome. I think the greatest threat to the 21st century is the collapse of free institutions through moral decline. And that's why I say the most important battle of now and the near future is the cultural battle, the moral battle. And we don't even know how to fight it. You can't fight it through the state. You can't trust the state. I mean, if anybody thinks they want to get moral instruction from the state, they're making a bad mistake. It's got to be done by a lively civil society, by intelligent people with good humor, and a way with wit and sound. I'll give you a very good example. The Pope, after Veritatis Splendor, the encyclical in which he argued that if the idea of truth collapses, democracy will collapse. And here's the basic point. If you have a people that doesn't believe in the truth, that doesn't believe in evidence, who believe in nihilism, that there's no such thing as good or evil, it's just what you think is good, what you think is good, it's just opinion. What they are basically saying is that the human mind cannot grasp hold of moral truth. If a society comes to believe that, then we're right back to Hitler and Mussolini, because that's where they began. There is no moral truth. The mind is incapable of finding moral truth. Therefore, they concluded, power is what matters. The human will is what matters. The person with the strongest will, who has the power to enforce it, will rule the world. That was their proposition. If there is no truth, power will fill the vacuum, and democracy is finished. It cannot happen in democracy. And so the Pope said, you must have the idea of truth, because if you have the idea of truth, then human beings will relate to one another by means of conversation. Civilized people argue with one another. Civilization is constituted by conversation. Barbarians club one another. Civilized people assume that the other person is rational. And you have to argue. You have to make a case. You have to produce evidence. And if you produce evidence, they will change their minds. Maybe not right away, but they will change their minds. Civilization proceeds by argument. Barbarism proceeds by clubs, by power. The idea of truth is the fundamental idea of civilization, and it's certainly the fundamental idea of democracy. It's a powerful idea. Anyway, my friend George was asked to go on a radio show with an ex-nun. Now, I don't know what it's like in Chile. Maybe you don't have ex-nuns. But in the North America, we have lots of ex-nuns. And believe me, they are something else. This woman is pro-abortion, and she wants women's ordination. She doesn't think there should be any priests, but she wants women to be priests if there are priests. It's not quite a reason. Anyway, she said the Pope's encyclical was nonsense. He was defending medieval absolutes, which nobody believes in anymore. And my friend George said, well, there are absolutes. He said, there are some things that people must never do. Nobody must ever do. And she said, name one. And he was stopped for a moment, and then quickly the flash of the light came to him, and he said, thou shalt not rape. And on the other side of the microphone, there is dead silence. That was the only absolute in the world she believes in, and she couldn't deny it, and he found it. Anything else she would have objected to. It was a marvelous moment. But you see my point. You can take anybody, any nihilist. He was at least a bit serious. And if you have wit, you can show them where they're not serious. All my friends who are relativists want the law to forbid smoking. They can't stand secondhand smoke. So in the land of the free and the home of the brave, you can't smoke in any building. We have, in the cold weather, secretaries wearing thin blouses, standing outside of their workplaces in the cold wind. You know, that's the fate of liberty in the hands of nihilists. They say there are no values, but they enforce theirs. We don't have any genuine nihilists. We have lots of people who say they are nihilists, but they all want to enforce their own morality using the state to do it. So they contradict themselves. In any case, I think the moral question is the meaning of liberty, the culture issue. That's what's the last third of this book. It's how to cope. Suppose capitalism wins, suppose democracy wins. What does Catholic social doctrine have to say about the moral and cultural question? In Poland, should the church insist that Catholic social doctrine be taught in all public schools? Or is that too much? Should the church find a way of teaching that outside the public schools, in the Catholic schools, maybe, but not impose it by law? In this respect, the church has lost a lot of prestige in Poland. When it spoke for liberty against communism, it was the great hero, of course, Polish culture. Everybody respected the church. Even atheists wanted the church. That after 1989, many clergy wanted to reinstate the power of the clergy as of 1930. They wanted to change all the laws to make them Catholic laws and impose Catholic doctrine in the schools. And there was rebellion against the church. There are many bad things happening through the election of communists. The communist president just now. It's not a good sign. But one good thing might happen providentially. Usually, in everything bad, there's something good. And one good thing may happen is the church will not be able to use the state to impose its ambitions. And it will force the church to become more active in civil society, to practice social justice outside the state. And the church will regain its public esteem again, I think. I think it will free the church from the burdens of the state. And it will give the state credibility. You will have to argue for what it wants. Arguments that are credible and convincing. That's healthy. Last things I want to say, assuming there aren't more questions, is there's a terrific irony happening in the world. All the philosophers in the Enlightenment who had as their project to create the city of man without reference to God. That's essentially what the Enlightenment is about. To create a self-consistent ethic apart from these, apart from the faith, Jewish Christian faith. To make, as Albert Camus put it, secular saints. People who live saintly lives without benefit of the gospel of the Bible. And the battle cry of the Enlightenment was reason. It's a curious thing, in North America at least, you cannot find philosophers who defend reason. Hardly at all. There are a few. They're not. The predominant ones say there is no such thing as reason. There's no such thing as objective truth. They're all deconstructionists. Deconstructionists believe that when you take sentences which purport to be about truth, they are actually statements defending the speaker's power. They reduce everything to a power question. And that is now the politically correct response on campus. There is no truth, there's only opinion. And anybody who claims to be speaking the truth is only disguising their own power. And their own grasping for power. So you have to unmask the claim to truth and show that it's simply an expression of a power relationship. So, we're in a position where the professors in the Enlightenment no longer believe in reason. And the only person who defends reason in the whole civilized world is the Pope, who defends natural law and reason. It's a curious inversion, isn't it? But it's true. The Pope, in very public splendor, is defending the idea, capacity of reason to reach truth. And he's criticized by philosophers who say there is no truth. It's a paradox. It turns the Enlightenment inside out. That's where we are. And let me say, for Judaism and Christianity, we need reason. We must defend reason. Because we say, it is the only way that a serious conscience can come to God is by being open to the evidence. God speaks to us through our reason. And even faith, we find reasonable. To go beyond reason in certain defined ways is reasonable, given the evidence. So we need to have, we believe in the Creator, so we must believe the world is made for reason. Christians must defend reason. Atheists and nihilists need not and often do not. It's a strange paradox. It makes a mockery of the last 300 years. But 20th century made a mockery of the last 300 years too. I'm just trying to say we are in a new intellectual position. And it's very important for, not just for Catholics, but for evangelicals, for Jews, for serious believers everywhere, serious humanists everywhere, to grasp the new situation and think through its implications in a different way than the party of the Enlightenment has for the last 300 years. And that's essentially what I've been trying to do and trying to express. So good luck.
Michael, muchas gracias.